Warm namaste to you all. I, Pritam Malakar, take absolute pleasure in welcoming our chief guest, Professor K. Ramasubramanian ji, esteemed members of faculty and students on behalf of Vande Mataram family. In the recent past, we have witnessed a dastardly attack on our armed forces in Pulwama, in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. This inhuman act of terrorism, which is the most nefarious crime against humanity, has shaken our national consciousness deeply and has brought public outcry in response. We will observe 1 minute silence for the soldiers who have attained Virgati due to this cowardly attack by Jaish-e-Mohammed. It is our humble request to you to put your cell phones in silent or switched off mode. Our Vande Mataram family is an independent student body of IIT Madras, and we endeavor to hold events to sensitize the student community and keep them abreast of India's rich cultural, economic, socio-political, scientific, and technological heritage, and its relevance today, contemporary issues, and thoughts about the roadmap ahead. This January, we have completed 4 years of service in this institute. Janani Janmabhumischa Swargadapi Gariyasi, which means the lap of our mother and motherland is greater than any joy of heaven, is the philosophy which has kept us going ahead in the last 4 years in this institute and strengthens our national consciousness. Vande Mataram, our national song, written by Sri Vankim Chandra Chattopadhyay, played a vital role in the Indian independence movement. An ode to the mother goddess, as it was written in the noble Anandamat, was a homage to mother and the motherland. This song inspired thousands of freedom fighters to come and contribute to the independence of our motherland. 28th February every year is observed as the National Science Day to mark the discovery of Raman effect by Sir C.V. Raman in the year 1928. Sir C.V. Raman is one of the greatest physicists India has ever got. Sir Raman's painstaking research work has contributed significantly to the field of science and technology in India and brought the system of scientific and technological development to where it is today. Every year, on 28th February, we hold a National Science Day lecture on campus by eminent scholars in the domain of science and technology. And we are immensely blessed to have Professor K. Ramasubramanian ji this evening with us as our chief guest and speaker. We have been proudly following the tradition of singing our national song, Vande Mataram, at the very beginning. And I would request you all to stand up at your place to sing the national song. I request Sri Hari Ganesh ji to sing the song.
Vande Mataram, Vande Mataram, Sujalam Suphalam Malayaj Sheetalam Sasya Shamalam Mataram, Vande Mataram, Shubhra Jyosna Pulakita Yamini Pullakusumita Dhrumadala Shobhini Suhasini Sumadhura Bhashini Sukhadam Varadam Mataram Vande Mataram Vande Mataram.
Today, our chief guest, Professor Ramasubramanian ji, will deliver the lecture on the subject, The Golden Age of Indian Mathematics. Professor K. Ramasubramanian is a professor at IIT Bombay in the cell for Indian Science and Technology in Sanskrit, at the Department of Humanities and Social Science. Professor Subramanian holds a doctorate in theoretical physics, a bachelor's in engineering, and a master's in Sanskritum. He is one of the authors who prepared detailed explanatory notes of the celebrated work Ganita Yukti Bhasha and Tanta Sangraha, which brings out the seminal contributions of the Kerala School of Astronomers and Mathematicians in the field of mathematics and astronomy, published by Springer's US and Hindustan Book Agency, New Delhi. Besides this, he has edited other works in Indian astronomy and mathematics, as well as authored several research papers, both individually and jointly with others. In 2008, he was conferred the prestigious award of Maharshi Badrinarayan Vyas Samman by the President of India in recognition of his scholarship, as well as the outstanding research work done by him in the process of synergy between modernity and tradition. In 2010, the National Academy, I warmly invite our chief guest, Professor Ramasubramanian ji, to please come up on the dais, and I also invite Professor Thamban Nair from the Department of Mathematics to present him a fruit basket. Now I request Professor Ramasubramanian ji to deliver his much anticipated talk.
Namaste, and a very good evening to you all. I'm quite delighted to be here to address this gathering, particularly on this National Science Day. The forum Vande Mataram, commencing with the beautiful song Sasya Shyamalam Mataram, was quite touching, and the Sasya Shyamala is something which is quite unique to India. Sasya, I just thought when I just heard the song, the Shyamala, something which is beautiful, etc., which can be there in many places. But it is this particular piece of land, I think that's what could have inspired this poet to say this, which can yield 3 crops a year. So, which I don't think many other nations in the world will be blessed with. So it is this nation which has been sort of crisscrossed with so many rivers and so on and so forth. So that is the kind of glory which he is trying to bring in. And therefore, we offer our venerations to that Mata. So Vande Mataram. So that is how, anyway, this is a very beautiful song. And we also want to do this Vande Mataram for the immense contributions that the intellectuals of these nations have done. So which is what we are going to see now. I asked the organizers, so the topic, they said it could be on this. And when this title came, this golden age, I was a bit puzzled which to be declared as golden age. So we will see that, why I was puzzled, and so the answer is something which I think will be evident by the time we complete this lecture. This golden age of Indian mathematics, so they have announced this in a very interesting way in the Facebook. So which is the golden age of Indian mathematics? What happened during this time? So this is what has been announced by the students. And they say India is known for mathematics. So known to whom? That is the question. By this I perhaps they mean, so known for its contributions. So, but known to whom is the question, and the later part of course is very true. We hardly know anything about Indian mathematics. And the qualifier Indian to mathematics is also something which we need to understand. By the way, so let me just tell you that you can feel free to raise your hand if you have some queries to be clarified even as lecture goes. Okay. So now, are there some landmark achievements which have been made by Indians? And if so, during which period? This is something which puzzles many people, as I can see in various fora. So they say, was this mathematics available to all? And we will highlight some of the remarkable discoveries and then make a few concluding remarks. So this is the outline. Mathematics in India, so can be broadly divided into a few time periods in which some remarkable contributions have come. One is, the period is something which is not quite evident to us because it is not recorded. So that belongs to the most ancient period, so wherein, I mean, some remarkable contributions have been made, but we don't know when it was precisely made because the dating of those texts is extremely difficult. So that is the first class. And one of the most remarkable class of texts during this period is called Shulba Sutras. The Shulba Sutras, they were roughly dated to be something like 800 BC, 500 BCE and so on and so forth. But precisely we do not know when exactly they were composed. There are other texts which are fairly well known, this Panini Sashtadhyayi Pingala's Chandas Sutra. Even there, I am not very sure, this is conservative estimate which has been made by scholars for Chandas Shastra as 200 BCE, because the style of the sutras seem to be indicating that they could be much prior. So this is my understanding. Anyway, thereafter, we had a galaxy of astronomers like Aryabhata, Brahmagupta, Bhaskara, Mahaviracharya. I don't think many of you would have heard about this Mahaviracharya. And Bhaskara is a fairly well-known name. Then we have the medieval period. Perhaps this is what these people had in their mind when they said this golden age. In fact, it has been declared as golden age by certain mathematicians earlier, so which is this period starting from 14th century. So we have this infinite series for pi. I was so happy to know when Professor Tamban Nair, so during the tea session before this lecture, so was informing me that during his lectures he makes it a point to highlight these names, Madhava and his contributions and so on and so forth. During this period, so some remarkable contributions have been made by mathematicians which really indicates to us that they had almost understood the foundations of what we call as calculus today. What is interesting is, so they have also got the derivatives for inverse trigonometric functions. So this is something which is quite interesting to note, and all of them have been beautifully codified in the form of nice verses. Then we have, of course, this Ramanujam Harishchandra S.R.S. Varadhan. So let me commence with an interesting preface, or rather a review, which David Mumford has written. Mumford, I don't know, some of you may be knowing, I think in 2008, he came here and then gave a lecture, having got inspired by the contributions made by the Indian astronomers and mathematicians. He wanted to have a series of talks arranged in Chennai Mathematical Institute, primarily on history of Indian mathematics, and some of us gave a talk. So thrilled by that, so immediately gave a talk in IIT Madras, I remember. Then he came to Bombay. he made it a point to give a talk at TAFR and also at IIT Bombay. And more or less the theme was the calculus of the East and the West. You understand? That was the kind of title that he gave. And when he, of course, gives that title, I don't think others can object. Okay. Anyway, so the interesting point that he makes is, so look at this. So he says, did you know that Vedic priests were using the so-called Pythagorean theorem to construct their fire altars around 800 BCE? The second part is something which is quite interesting. The differential equation of the sine function in finite difference form was described by Indian mathematician astronomers in the 5th century. Can you guess who is it? Aryabhata, 5th century. So it is Aryabhata who composed his work in 499 AD. So let me just share an interesting anecdote which many of you may not know. So when the series of talks were organized in Chennai Mathematical Institute, so Mumford was sitting in the front row with a notebook and a pen, meticulously noting down what were given. So I had the occasion to speak on this Aryabhata and his contributions. So when he saw the thing which was given by Aryabhata, so he immediately jumped up from the chair and then said, see, this is the differential equation in finite difference form. So then only I started using the same terminology. So that was a very interesting event which made me feel quite proud of the remarkable contribution made by Aryabhata. So that is what he refers to. We will come back to that little later. And then Grigori's series, pi by 4. So this is the series which is well known. And it was proved by Indian mathematicians. And it is primarily Kerala mathematicians. So let me go and then tell you the context in which certain interesting mathematical discoveries were made by Indian mathematicians in the ancient period. If you go to a traditional household person, I mean, who still practices these yaga rituals, etc., they may be somayajis and so on. So usually we refer to them as Agnihotris, okay? So there are so many people who have the title Agnihotri. So that doesn't mean that they do Agnihotra. So this Agnihotra is a certain ritual which is being performed by people, and this is the kind of altar which they will have permanently in one of the rooms in their house. So here if you look at, so you have a circular altar, you have a semicircular, and you have a square one. Now the construction of these altars is such that, so you impose the constraint that the area of all the three should be same. So now you can very easily see, so the earliest search for the value of pi. So if you want to get the area of a circle, obviously you need to know something, and that gives, okay? So this is something which you find in Shulva Sutras around this period. Then we have a very, very interesting pidan. So this is something around 800. So we have several Shulva Sutras. So Shulva Sutra of Bodhayana, Shulva Sutra of Katyayana, Shulva Sutra of Manava, and so on and so forth. So this Bodhayana Shulva Sutra has been estimated to be the earliest, and the people have estimated around 800 BCE. Okay. Now, this approximation for root 2, as we find here, is again a very interesting thing, so which gives the value of root 2 correct to almost 5 to 6 decimal places. How did mathematicians arrive at it, and what sort of motivated them to get this? One reason can be something which is very evident to us. If I have a certain area and I want to construct an area which is twice that, so obviously you need root 2. So if you have root 2 as measure and that is the side of the square, it will give you twice the area. And there are interesting constructions which have been described in Shulva Sutra texts which enable you to find out by a simple measurement the value of any third, root n, so which I will come to a little later. But this approximation to root 2 which has been presented has a very interesting form. So 1 by 3 plus 1 by 3 by 4, 3, 4 into 34 and so on and so forth. And this is again stated in a very simple sutra. So there are quite a few students who seem to be knowing Sanskrit here. I'll just give you the sutra. See, pramanam is a certain unit of measure. How does the sutra go? It says, tritiyena vardhayet. So increase by 1/3. So pramanam tritiyena vardhayet. Then it will say, tachaturthena. See, so tachaturthena, the tat refers to whatever you got in the immediately preceding one. 1/4 you increase, again vardhayet. Then it will say, atma chatustrimshena unena. See, una is something which you have to subtract. Chatustrimsha is 34. Atma chatustrimsha means 1/34 of what you have got previously. That you have to subtract and that will give you. The sutra doesn't stop there. It says, savisheshaha. So the savisheshaha, that's where the crux lies. So he says that it is something which is not exact. So there is something which is more important. Okay, so vishesha means some peculiarity. So there is a vishesha to this, and that's why we have used this approximate symbol here. Okay, so in the construction of these kind of altars, there are almost a dozen kinds of altars of various shapes, something in the form of tortoise, something in the form of falcon, and so on and so forth. So the problem that these Shulvakaras faced was the constraint imposed will be that the number, okay, of tiles which you have to use has to be of some quantity, and the area of this is again fixed. So then you have to design your tiles and so on and so forth. It is in this context, so various things have been done. These are all things about ancient period I am talking about, so whose dates are precisely not known because it is not recorded. Then we have this Chandas Shastra. In fact, somebody showed me a book there. So this Chandas Shastra, which has been authored by Pingala. So this Pingala's Chandas Shastra has around 300 sutras. And this is also an Ashtadhyayi, like our Panini's Ashtadhyayi. It has been composed in 8 chapters. So it basically deals with the problems that would arise to a pure mathematician when he studies the topic of Chandas. So he presents various interesting recursive relations in the last chapter. So he starts with the definition of what are various ganas which will be employed. And in the last chapter, we find almost all the combinatorial mathematics, particularly dealing with the binary numbers. That is what we find there. So the problem is, given an n-syllable meter, so how many possible rhythms that you can generate? So that is the kind of question. So, sasya shamalam mataram. How many syllables? 8. So this, given eight syllables to you, how many patterns can you have? Each one can be guru or laghu. Say 2^8 patterns that you can have. Given 8 syllables, each of the syllable can be guru or laghu. And therefore you will get 2^8. So that is the question. And here you see, so if 0 syllables is given, there can be only 1 pattern. There is nothing, okay? Now if 1 syllable is given, it can be either guru or laghu. So therefore 2^1. If 2 syllables are given, so then it can be guru-guru, guru laghu, laghu laghu. Okay? So 3 syllables, guru guru guru, so guru guru laghu, guru laghu laghu. Right? So now this sequence that you find here, which has been arranged in this form, essentially is what we call as what do we call? Pascal's triangle. And straight away what you have here is the binomial coefficients. Okay? Now what has motivated these people to come up with this is basically the question that they pose to themselves as a pure mathematician. So it's not that given 8 syllables you will be having all the kind of patterns that... So this is a question that arises to a pure mathematician, and that is something which is quite remarkable here. So you see straight away binomial coefficients. This is called Meru Prastara. Why is it called Meru Prastara? Meru Sadrishaha. Meru is basically a kind of a mountain kind of a thing. Sadrishaha, something which is similar to. Prastara is basically spreading. So spreading the numbers like this. Why is it important? You will be able to list. Prastara is basically sort of listing all the patterns, all the various rhythms that are possible. Once you do this, you pose this question, in how many patterns will I have only two gurus? In how many patterns will I have only one laghu? And so on and so forth. That is what gives rise to all this. Okay? So for instance, what is Guru Laghu? So if those who are not aware, Ramo Vanam Gataha, for instance, this is Guru Guru, Va is short, Nam is Laghu, Nam is Guru, Ga is Laghu, Ta is Guru. Okay? So it is basically refers to the time period required for pronouncing a particular syllable. Okay? So that is what it is. So Guru is two beats and Laghu is one beat. Now you have this interesting recursive relation, which is essentially the Fibonacci sequence, as we call. Okay? So where does it arise? It arises in the context of finding the patterns that are possible when it comes to matra vritta. Okay? So one is syllables. You give the number of syllables and then you find the patterns. So then the restriction can be the number of beats that is given to you. So the number of beats, so if it is fixed, so the patterns that you can generate, so either Guru Laghu, so that is a different thing, and that will straight away give you what is called this Fibonacci sequence, and so that is what it is. So this recursive relation that we have is all available in the text. It is all in Pingala's Chandas Shastra 8th chapter. So that's where he deals with most of the mathematics. So the first chapter gives certain definitions, then he gives the definitions of various meters that are possible, and the final chapters he deals with lots of mathematics. So the proof is also something which is very interesting. And okay, now this question is a very interesting question that he poses towards the end. So given a certain number of syllables to you, what are the possible combinations, rhythms that you will be able to generate up to that? So which means you start with one and then start one syllable, two syllables and so on and so forth. That is the sequence that you will have. And how does the sutra provide this number? Dvirdvyunam tadantanam. So this is the sutra which we find. Dvirdvyunam tadantanam. So that is the sutra that we have. And here, there is a very interesting shloka, which I found. Shadvim shatis sapta shatani chaiva tatha sahasranyapi sapta pantihi lakshani drigveda susam mitani kotyas tatha ramanisha karaisyuhu. What is this? Ekaksharadi Shadvimshatyanta jati prastara pinda sankhya. You understand? Yeka aksharadi means given one akshara. Given one akshara, there are two possibilities. It can be guru or laghu, two patterns. Where does it end? Shadvimshati means 26. Okay? So the maximum number of syllables given is 26. So starting from 1 to 26, so what will be the count? Okay, of the maximum possible rhythms. So that has been nicely presented by this man in the form of a shloka. And what does it come to? See, 13 crores, 42 lakhs, 17,726. Okay, so this is the number. Shadvim shati saptashatani. Shadvim shati is 26. Saptashatani is 700. Tatha sahasranyapi sapta panktihi. What is this pankti? Panti means row, but here what do we need? When you calculate this number, you have Sahasra is 1000, Sapta is 7, so Panti should be 1. So we have this what is called Bhuta Sankhya. So in Bhuta Sankhya, the word Panti and Rupa are generally used. Of course, Chandra, etc., various things, physical objects, they refer to number 1. So number 1 because Why is this pankti called one? Rupa, you can understand. Why is Rupa called one? There are infinite forms, right? But the form of a particular thing is unique. So the form of either it is a human being or any other thing, okay, at whatever level we want to, so they have some unique form, either the spin will vary, this will vary, that will vary, whatever. So this form is sort of unique, and therefore Rupa is used to refer to number one. So too Pankti is used. Pankti basically means sort of row. But in this context, we need to understand that they are talking about the patterns that can be generated. You understand? Even if you take a three-syllabled meter, guru, 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 right? So guru, guru, laghu. So if you put all the eight combinations, each row will have a unique pattern. Okay? And therefore, they use the word pankti to refer to number one. It has a unique form. So therefore, this sapta panktihi sahasrani, then lakshani, drigveda, drig means I, okay, two, veda is four, therefore 42, drigveda susammitani, then koti, how many kotis? Kotyastatha, ramanishakaraisyuhu, what is ramanishakara? So Rama is three. Why? Parashurama, Ayodhya Rama and Balarama. Okay. So there are Rama. Nishakara? Nisha means moon. Okay. Divakara refers to sun. And Nishakara refers to moon. So moon is only one for earth. And therefore, that is number 13. Okay. Rama Nishakaraisyuhu. See, this number 2 to the power of 26, so for you to find out is not a trivial thing, okay? You understand? So if you memorize this, see, that is all. No time you can tell. But interestingly, what you have to understand is, this number is basically arithmetic sum, geometric sum. So the geometric sum is what we need, right? So 2 to the power 2, 2 to the power 3, 2 to the power n. So that geometric sum, so he has basically given, and he presents you a certain technique by which you will be able to find out this geometric sum in a far, far, far more efficient way than you will otherwise do. Okay? So 2 to the power 26, so if you do it in a monotonic way, you should do 26 multiplications. Okay? But he will give you a certain procedure by which you will be able to do in much, much, so logarithmically, I will just say. So that is a very interesting procedure which has been given in this Pingala Chandas Sutra text. Okay, now this ancient period is more or less over. And one more small thing. This, of course, we all know that decimal place value system has been presented by Indians. And this is a very interesting quotation which I found. He says, most of the great discoveries and inventions of which the Europe is so proud would have been impossible without the development of the system of mathematics, and this in turn would have been impossible if Europe had been shackled by the unwieldy system of Roman numerals. So on and so on and so forth. So this looks, this simplicity generally is taken to be a trivial thing. Okay. In fact, so that should not be mistaken. So that is the kind of thing. So this seems to be so evident to us and much simple. But when you actually look into the other forms of representation of numbers, suppose I give you 28 into 42, you will just put place by place, you multiply and you will get the value. So you represent 28 by Roman numerals and 42 by Roman numerals. How will you multiply? You understand? V111, right? So that is what he means by saying, so this shackled by unwieldy system of Roman numerals. So there is a certain brilliance in trying to represent that. And so that is what is something which is remarkable about this decimal place value system, both. Okay. So that is something which could be considered as the contribution of Indians in the ancient period. And so too, this of course Laplace, who is well known to us, so for various discoveries that he has made, he is also in great praise of this, okay? The ingenious method of expressing every possible number okay, using 10 symbols, each symbol having a place value and absolute value, emerged in India. So this is a remarkable contribution which has been made by Indians in the ancient period. So you see, almost every binary arithmetic you will be able to find out in the Pingala's Chandas Shastra, and the decimal place value system which has facilitated us in doing various computations is also something which can be seen here, okay? Then we have this very large periods called Kalpa and so on and so forth, and Kalpa, so those of you who are sort of familiar with Bhagavad Gita 8th chapter, so there also it mentions Sahasra Yuga Paryantam Maharyat Brahmano Vidhu Ratrim Yuga Sahasrantam Teho Ratra Vidho Janaha. So the Sahasra Yuga Paryantam, that is what is basically called as Kalpa. So Yuga is this 43,20,000 and Sahasra is 1,000. So this is something, see, this a fascination for having large numbers is something which you can see in those ancient periods, and that is what made them come up with this Yuga system. And what is this Yuga? Why is it called Yuga? So there are a lot of people who have great interest in Sanskrit, so that's why I thought I'll just tell you. So this Yuga, Yujyante Asmin Graha Iti Yugaha. You understand? So this is a large period in which you will see that the planets almost make integral number of revolutions. It will not be exact. So Yujyante means they start, so each one keeps moving at its own rate, and you will find a large period in which almost all of them make integral revolutions, and they will meet at the same point. So that is what is meant by Yuga. Why did they conceive of this large period? So this will sort of explain, okay? So that is what it is. Okay. How could they arrive at this large period? So first is, you have to observe the period of Mercury. It will be some 88.2432. So in the first observation, you will get something close to 88. Second observation, you may get 88.2. Third observation, you will get some, or after 50 years of observation, you may get the second decimal place. So even for them to compute the period and arrive at this number, so they should have made some hundreds and thousands of years of observation. So that is something which we need to understand and appreciate when you think of the way the Indian astronomers present this. And for you to compute this, so that is where this indeterminate equation of the first order comes, which is called Kuttakara. Okay? So this Kuttakara is a certain technique. So Ax plus By is equal to C is the kind of equation. So we have to, A, B, C are known. We have to find X and Y as integers. So that is the kind of a solution which, so it is sort of related to that. So as you can see that, so this basically gave rise to a brilliant mathematical technique by which you will be able to solve equations. And this fascination for huge numbers, so which we find in Yugas and various other places, is something which one can trace back in the Vedic period, because we have this numbers up to Parartha. Parartha is almost 10 to the power of 12. So we have Shata Yaswaha, Sahasra Yaswaha, Ayuta Yaswaha, Niyuta Yaswaha. So this is a Vedic passage which goes up to Parartha. Okay, so coming to this notion of zero and infinity, so it's not quite clear when they arrived at the number per se, zero and infinity. The concepts of void and infinite has been there for a long time. But the number, so putting them into zero and infinity, you will not be able to precisely date. But definitely by the time of Brahmagupta, there are various people who keep talking about, see this Wikipedia and so on, there are various sources in the Google which gives you not necessarily correct information, okay? So there are various people say Aryabhatta discovered zero, etc. These are all not correct. So we should not just say this. So there are some people who come and ask me, so Aryabhatta proposed a heliocentric system. Ye bilkul galat hai. So heliocentric system, by the way, is impossible, okay, through naked eye observation. Unless you have powerful telescopes, so which will be giving us certain resolution which you can see through that instrument, it will not be possible for you to experimentally do that. Even when Copernicus gave, so it is all speculation. So it is not based on observation. So you have to understand this. So it is impossible for Aryabhatta to give or somebody else to give that Earth is moving around the sun. Astronomy is observational science. So as an observational science, you should be able to explain how they have done. Most of the things that we find here will be explained by the commentators, how they determine and so on and so forth. So that is something which is very important. I just wanted to mention, by the time of Brahmagupta, so who was in 7th century. So now I move on to the classical period, okay, leave out the ancient period. So it starts with around the 5th century, wherein we have a classical text which is available in the form of Aryabhatiya. Aryabhatiya, though a text on astronomy, it has a certain chapter which is called Ganitapada, so which deals with mathematics. In around 33 verses, he gives the necessary mathematics which will be employed. So that is where we find precise operations with zero and so on and so forth, and arithmetic operations with zero, multiplying, what will happen, dividing, what will happen, and so on, is given by Brahmagupta, only around 7th century. In the ancient period, there is one more interesting thing which I thought I should just bring it to your notice. So which I said, so root 2 we find expressions, rational approximations for certs. Some certs we find in actual numerical value given in Silva Sutras. But Silva Sutras also give you a geometrical way of determining root n. So that is what this Katyayana Silva Sutra gives. This is a brilliant way by which you will be able to simply make a measurement of approximate value of root n, whatever you want to determine. So how does it go about? See, this is the prescription. See, Yavanti Chaturashrani Eki Kartum Chikirishet. That is how the sutra will proceed. So as many squares as you want to club, which means it can be n. So you want to determine root n. Okay? So that the total area is n times the original area. So it is in this context, this sutra is prescribed. And what is interesting to note here is this. This prescription by the author that you measure what is AD will give you root n. It would be impossible for anybody to come up with this prescription unless he had worked out the necessary algebra by this procedure. Okay? So you should have done this algebra, then only you will be able to say, you take a measure n minus 1 a, this time n plus 1 by 8, a by into a by 2 by this side, and then you measure this, that will give you root n times a. So this would be impossible unless he has done this. Now, the point to be noted here is, so there is a blend of geometry, arithmetic, and algebra, which you can see in this simple prescription of finding root n. Okay? So this is a very, very simple, nice, elegant way of determining root n. This is a very interesting quote which I saw and I thought I should share with this audience. There was a brilliant mathematician called A.A. Ramaswamy Iyengar. Not many of us may be knowing him. He was in Mysore. This A.K. Ramanujam, who is his son, so he is more well known. Okay, and this A.K. Ramanujam's father, Ramaswamy Iyengar, he writes an article about the mathematician Ramanujan. Okay, Srinivasa Ramanujan. Ramanujan. So this is a passage which is worth reading. So which gives us a lot of insight about the workings of the Indian mathematicians in general, so which is sort of known in Ramanujan at a later stage, with whom we are familiar with. He says, every mathematician now feels blah, blah, blah. Now he says, it is therefore remarkable that an Indian genius should arise who could do without all European mathematical elaborations and could plunge straight into modern mathematics and come up with dazzlingly new results. So this all of us know about Ramanujan. But what he speaks of Ramanujan is something which is applicable to these people also earlier. See, directly, so that is how they present their mathematics. See, it's not that some working has not gone inside their mind. So there is a working which goes on and you are able to do it and you simply present the result. And there is another reason why they present only the result, because this has been a oral tradition and you want to just retain that, and any other thing can be explained by the person. So in, and there was no medium to write. So today, if you look at, so I was quite puzzled and surprised how this kind of 800 page volume of mathematics for a seventh standard, you know? I don't know, I'm sure any of you who has gone to US, you just go, look at the 7th standard book, 8th standard book. Each of them will be 700 plus pages, no exaggeration. Okay, so that is how things are presented. So these books are not brought. So you say, our people carry with a big to school, there nothing is carried. You will have a copy there in your school and you will have a copy. Those who can purchase a copy, they will have at home. If they don't have money, so they will just look at in the school only. But the size of the volume is like this. So for explaining, so you take so many pages. So here we have been presenting things. The entire mathematics is in two A4 pages. So that is what Aryabhatta has given to you. Okay, 108 verses you can print in four A4 sheets. Okay, even if it is single side. Ho gaya, tumhara pura mathematics and astronomy. So this is how, I mean, they have been presenting. No, no, the point is, so that is what he is trying to say. See, lot of things can be done mentally. So it is a certain training. So once you have this training, you may be able to do. And that seems to be the kind of a tradition. So that's what he is trying to say here. India has had brilliant mathematicians in the past who gave the world. The Hindu mind has always shown peculiar aptitude for fundamental thinking, digging down into the depths of thought with minimum of external equipment. While other minds are after heavy superstructures and complicated scaffolding tools and machinery. One extraordinary illustration of this trait of the Hindu mind we have in Ramanujan. So this is how he introduces the article. It was a very nice passage. I thought I should just share with you. Okay. Now, the techniques are also very simple. So let me just skip this. And let me move on. The techniques which they prescribe are pretty simple and straightforward for doing various measurements, even in astronomy. The prescription may be simple, but the kind of mathematics that should have been done for them to come up with the prescription is something which is remarkable. So that is what when Rama, our Iyengar says, without much of scaffolding and so on and so forth, they do not really elaborate all this. And there are verses which will say that you have to give the hints to the student. You should not spoon feed them. So let them think and come up with that. So that is the kind of thing that they seem to have followed. Not that they don't want to hide something, because that is how people have been sort of visualizing. Okay, they wanted to keep it as a secret. Aisa kuch nahi hai. Okay. So this has been the tradition and they had to do that way, that's all. Now, the ubiquity of mathematics is something so which has been beautifully brought out by Mahaviracharya in his work called Ganitasārasan. What did you do? Okay. So this Ganitasārasan commences with a set of verses which will be sort of quite inspiring and motivates the student to take up mathematics seriously. So he says, laukike vaidike chapi tatha samayike piyaha vyaparas tatra sarvatra sankhyanam upayujyate. See, so laukike vaidike samayike, what does it mean? So laukika is basically your day-to-day transactions. So vaidika, even if you want to construct the altars, etc., in that context. And samayika, anything which has to do with societal activities. So everywhere, the sankhyanam upayujyate. You cannot do away with that. Then he says, kama tantre. So there also you have to do a lot of calculations, right? kama tantre. Then artha shastre. So that is also there, economics. Gandharva, all of us know. See, whether it is music or dance, there has to be beautiful rhythm. So you have to keep the count of beats, otherwise, I mean, everything will go wrong. Okay, this is very important. So Gandharve, Natake, Viva, Supa Shastre, cooking. So Supa Shastra is cooking, okay? So Supa Shastre, Tatha Vaidye. So how much of this has to be mixed with that? So even if you want to use Ayurveda Churna or whatever it is, so any mixing, so that makes a lot of difference. So everywhere you need this. Then Chandaha Alankara Kavyeshu Tarka Vyakaranadishu Ka Kala Guneshu Sarveshu Prastutam Ganitam Param. Then finally he says, Bahubhir Vipralapaihkim Trailokye Sacharachare Yatkinchid Vastu Tatsarvam Ganitena Vinanahi. Okay, so it is a very categorical statement. Okay. Bahubhir Vipralapaihkim. What is the point in lamenting and I can keep on listing some 60 items? So that doesn't really make much sense. So I will just stop here. I have given a few examples. Trailokye Sacharachare, in all the three worlds. So Yatkinchid Vastu, whatever you think of. Okay, so ganitena vinanahi, without mathematics you can't go anywhere. Okay, so that is what is manifesting in biology, in economics, in social sciences, everywhere that we see here. And so regarding the way they present, so these are all some nice things. Yes, please.
I think that song should be declared like the national anthem of mathematics.
Yeah, you can call it. So it is something which is a very, very categorical statement, and a statement which is made out of, with a lot of thinking in it. So this is a brilliant statement which he comes up.
Given your position and you have this included as, at least as, like, you know, we have the national anthem in every school textbook, like, you know, Janaganamana. Can't this be included?
If you actually include this, so then they will question you, it is in Sanskrit, therefore. How can you include it? No. Forget about all this. Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya is being questioned, and what are we talking about? So lead me to light. I mean, this prayer cannot be included. Anyway, so the point is, I mean, the mindset has to change. Okay, I'm happy that you raised this. So this is a very, very important statement. That's what I want to tell you. So the importance has been brought. See, Pavaluri Mallanna, that work unfortunately has not been even brought out. So there is something which has been written. See, the other thing that we need to understand is, I'm happy that you... See, people have been trying to make it available in the local languages. And even in the local languages, see, there is something which we need to appreciate here. If you can present something in the form of a poetry, so then your comprehension of it is something which is increasing. So your creativity increases, everything increases. So there is no unique way. I mean, you can compose in a different meter which will be far more interesting, and therefore, so all these things have to be understood. So you can increase the proficiency in the language, you can increase the creativity. There are too many things that you can think of even in trying to present. See, today, I mean, we have some 248 electromagnetic theory textbooks. So how are they different from each other? So all meaningless. So and there will be some 1,48,000 articles on caste system and its... So how 1,48,000 articles, how kind of new things are being stated? Nothing. So this is something which can really be very interesting and productive, and you can learn the master skills in language, and there are various things which one can... think of the benefits of doing. It is not necessarily Sanskrit I'm saying. So take any language. So language has its own beauty, every language. And these texts, I mean, even Tamil. So I heard that this is something which is common in Bengal also. But those things are all gone. So those people who have made these attempts, there also they will compose in nice rhythms. Every language has poetry. So they have been trying to take this to people. And elementary mathematics is something which is essential for everybody. You don't need to do Lie algebra. Okay? But the elementary mathematics is very essential, and we are just missing that. So that ability to compute things quickly and mentally is something which is very essential, and it is an important faculty that is worth developing. And there are some interesting formulae, so which have been beautifully codified in the form of verses. I just wanted to tell you that, so those who are familiar with the vritta, can you tell me what the vritta is? Vritta kshetre parithigunitav vyasapadaf phalam tatu. Are you familiar? Prithakshetre paridhi guni tu vyasa padaf palam tat. This is Mandakanta. Kaschit kanta virha guruna swadhikara atpramattaha. Prithakshetre paridhi guni tu vyasa padaf palam tat. Very good. So the definitions are given. See, in the local language, I'm saying. So this, Mandakranta Ambudhirasanagair Mopano Taugayugmam. That is how it is constructed in Sanskrit. So what I'm saying is, these are all vrittas. So various things, various languages have redefined it. So that is how. So you see the area of a circle, so the surface area of a sphere, and the volume. So all of them have been nicely presented in one single verse. Okay, so this is Bhaskaracharya's verse. And of course, he gives you the proof how to arrive at this. In a completely different way, let me tell you. So it's not like taking elementary area dx dy or r d theta d phi. So uske bina bhi kar sakte hain. But it is essentially, I mean, the principle of integration will be there, but in a completely different and intuitive way. So these things have been done. So even as we teach the regular way of teaching calculus, this will be quite instructive to teach how to arrive at the same result in a completely different way. So that is how the importance of this has to be understood. There are other interesting things which will I thought I should just tell you. These various things that we find here in another work, which is called Ganita Kaumudi. This will also enhance the skills to do things mentally. So magic squares constructing this will excite children. So given a number, you come up with a magic square, right? So each one can come up. This is something which will be very useful as a creative exercise. So this you can see dealt with extensively in almost 70, 80 verses. So this is in the classical period. So these are all things. See, normally we think of magic squares which will, the rows will sum up, the columns will sum up, and the main diagonals will sum up. So the Indians have prescribed methods by which you will be able to construct pan-diagonal magic square. Okay? So this pan-diagonal magic square, see, you see, so if you take this, so 10, and you have to just say 6 plus 7 plus 11, you will get 34. Okay? So even the pan-diagonal things come up, and this is not necessarily for 1 to 16, you can give any number. Give 247, you will be able to get. So they have a systematic procedure for constructing pan-diagonal magic squares. That is something which is again a very interesting topic. So this is something which we need to know. So
is that the pan-diagonal square which is using avadana?
Essentially. Avadana is, of course, they also, one of them that they do is this magic square. There are different techniques by which you can do. I'm not sure whether they do pan-diagonal. If they do pan-diagonal, then I mean maybe they follow this, one of this. Okay. so this also maybe, So this is again, there are some, the point I wanted to convey was, there is something which will be very useful as recreational mathematics, which will create creativity. Okay. So that is, in that context, I'm just giving a few things in the medieval period. So which are sort of quite unique. So this construction, so this is something which has to do with astronomy and mathematics. So there is something called Prahelika in Sanskrit, which will be posed as a riddle. So they, Praheli bolte hain, acha. Paheli. Paheli. See, the authors present their date of composition not necessarily explicitly. So this author has presented, so you have to solve this equation, then you will be able to get the date. What does this equation mean? See, you know, there is Panchanga. Panchanga pata hai aapko? Kya kya hai? Tithi, Vara, Nakshatra, Yoga, Karana. Karana. Now he gives you the riddle like this. The date of composition will be that. Okay, what is that? Yoga will be equal to Masa square, Tithi will be equal to Yoga by 2, and Vara will be equal to Tithi into 3, and Bha means nakshatra. The star sankhya will be V by 2. You understand? So that date on which all these stars satisfied will be the date of my composition in that year. See, this is a nice riddle that he poses. You understand? Yogo masa krite samaha. Masa kriti he means M square. Yoga will be M square. Karahrito yogaha. See, yoga by 2 will be the tithi. So on and so on and so forth. So this is how he presents. So these are all very interesting and creative ways of presenting things. Now let me come to the last part. So third, okay, section of this. See this, there are some very interesting techniques, simple techniques by which you will be able to precisely give the local time. What we use is standard time, okay, Indian standard time. So for the entire width from Meghalaya to either Gujarat, so we use that. But what we require is local time for us to do various things. Otherwise there will be lag of 1.5 hours, itana latitude mein. So that is, so the longitudinal difference. So this local time can be precisely measured by a simple technique by erecting a stick, which is called shanku, which they call, and this will be the formula. Now, for him to prescribe this formula, there is a lot of spherical trigonometry which is being conceived by him. So otherwise it is impossible to prescribe this. So, and the other thing that you need to notice is, we have this cosine function, sine function, and so on. And this Z is basically the zenith distance of the sun as it passes. So sun, zenith distance will be zero, right? When it is on the horizon, and when it is up, so the zenith distance keeps on increasing, okay? The zenith distance is that. Zenith distance will be 90 when it is on the horizon, right? So the altitude will keep increasing, zenith distance will keep decreasing. So you have to basically measure the zenith distance, and if the latitude and the declination are known, then you will be able to get the local time. Now, for you to, even when you use this equation, unless you have precise ways of determining the sine function and cosine function, it will not be possible for you. So that actually necessitated them to come up with sine tables for more and more accurate values of sines. Okay, so I'm sure some of the professors here, like me, would have used only sine tables, like some Clark's table book will be there. So abhi to wo sab nahi, so tuck, press a button and you will get. But what is behind, what does that button do? So that not many of us understand. So even when you use packages, that's what I tell my students. When you use a certain software, you try to understand what goes behind that. Then you will be able to handle it much better, so rather than using it as a black box. So this sign, so they developed some interesting ways of remembering the sign table. Say like our multiplication table, oh, sign table bhi contest kiya jayega. Okay, so you just memorize that and you will be able to invoke, okay? So there is a systematic way and beautiful way of doing. And the earlier Siddhantas themselves give these values. See, that it is r by 2, root of r by 2, and root 3 by 2, r. These four values. Once you know these values, then you will be able to construct the entire sine table, let me tell you. All that is required is you need to know how to find square root and how to find square. If you know these two, then you can construct the entire sine table. That is what has been done in the ancient texts. And there are interesting verses which you will find even in Aryabhatiya. So Aryabhatiya, as I told you, is a 5th century text. So he gives you a certain nice geometrical method by which you can construct your own sine table. See, this is a very, very instructive, I must tell you, that people do not really understand how the sine value comes. So you know only sine x is equal to x minus x cube by 3 factorial. That you study when you are doing bachelor's. But later if I ask you what is the series for sine function, that also they don't remember precisely. So this devices, they use that. But there is a much more interesting way of understanding sine function and how it is related to geometry. So that is something which I find extremely instructive. Okay. So though I did in the regular stream, so mathematics, theoretical physics, and so on and so forth, When I read some of them, I find it really fascinating and very, very instructive. So we have some geometrical method, and we have this. This is what it is. So as I was mentioning earlier, the equation which struck our David Mumford was this equation. See, so this delta here represents this first order sign difference. So, and difference of two first order sign differences is essentially second order sign difference. In the right hand side, what do you find? J. J is jia. Jia is sign. So now the second order sign difference is essentially d square y by dx square in its continuous form. And that is same as this. So that is what it is. So this is what he meant by the in the discrete form, differential equation in the discrete form. So this is what is given by Aryabhata. And how does he give the numerical value? He gives in the form of verse. Makhi, bhaki, bhaki, dhaki, nakhi, nyakhi. Okay? So this is the verse which gives you all the sign differences. Okay? So that is in one verse. A verse contest ho gaya, sign table ho gaya. One way. Okay? So this is how Aryabhata presents. Of course, later astronomers present in a different way. And we also have another interesting rational approximation. These are all remarkable discoveries, let me tell you, in those periods. Okay? So when the entire world was using only tables, you find Indians giving you an analytic relation by which you will be able to determine sign function. Okay? So this is what one means by the peak of mathematics, right? Golden age. So in those dates, around those periods, these are some remarkable relations. Okay. Now comes the real golden age. Okay. So which is what has been highlighted by you, this Kerala mathematicians. So they come up with this infinite series for sine, and this series, which normally goes by the name Grigori Leibniz. Why is it called Grigori Leibniz? Un dono mein ladai ho gaya. So who discovered first? Okay, so if you look at the history of mathematics, so then they decided that let us give credit to both. But donon ko chhod ke, so we have to say this to be Madhava, if one has to really give the credit to the first founder. So this series has been presented by Madhava in the form of a short verse, as we understand today. And this actually, see, Trisharadi Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. That is how Madhava will give. Three means three. Shara means five. Vishama Sankhya means odd numbers. Bhaktam means divided. You understand? Trisharadi Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. Then Rinam Swam. Rinam means minus. Swam means plus. Prithak Kramat Kuryat. Okay? So that is how he presents the series. Okay? So it is a simple, nice verse. So we will never forget. Okay, so that is how this has been presented to us by Madhava. Then I was mentioning to you that they have also come up with the derivatives of inverse functions. So this will again be in the form of a verse. So this is something which they had to find out. D by dt of this function. So you find this relation precisely given in a shloka. So this is definitely around 15th century, if not before. So by around 14th century or 15th century, so we find this verse given, and it is attributed to someone called Damodara. Okay? Yeah, you tell me. So, yes, please.
If we are so clear about all this, I can understand 400 to 500 years we went through slavery.
Yeah, it is precisely the question which bothers me also. there has been a certain attitude. See, the point is, this is something which is very genuine. This is so clear, you understand?
Crystal clear,
but who knows about this? The problem is, the textbooks on history, I will give you one or two instances. Off late, they have started recognizing that this is Indian contribution. But let me tell you that there are ample evidences to show that they have been trying to conceal this. And there has been a lot of hesitation in accepting that they could have discovered. Okay, I'll give you one or two instances that will make things clear. Now, the system has been said to us, we have to overcome it. And we have been mindlessly following the same stream. So that is where the problem is. So this is something which is there.
Huh.
No, no, no. Let me tell you, today, how do you teach Newton's laws? How do you teach Maxwell's equations? Did Maxwell write it in this form? No, no, no. Please understand that notations keep changing. So we develop certain things for convenience at a later stage. So what forms the basis for this is something which we need to understand. So our Nobel laureate Chandrasekhar has to write a commentary on Principia. So the thing is, so the notations which were available at, in those points of time is something which we need to keep in mind. So for us to appreciate it, so we just put it. So there are certain advantages in using this, there are certain advantages in using that. So if you have lost that particular tradition, then it becomes very difficult for us to even digest how at all they could have done this. Let me tell you one simple example. So today we have forgotten even simple multiplications and how to keep things in mind. 40 years before, when I used to go to this vegetable vendor, I remember distinctly, he will have some 5 people purchasing 5 different items, each one. And for everyone, he will give you the exact value. How was he able to compute? I don't even understand. Precise. So he will be doing distributing in no time wasted. No. The problem is, I'll tell you. So I'm happy that this was raised. See, last September, I was in US. And there, in a particular, the Seattle, so people wanted me to address a group of school teachers and so on. There, the person who organized this talk, so he gave me a few books. That is how I came to know that each book is some 700, 800 pages. So he said that there is something called, the STEM. You know STEM?
Yeah.
What is STEM?
Science, technology.
So science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, okay? STEM education. What are the lessons that we can learn from Indian mathematics for STEM education? I mean, this is the kind of thing that he was expecting me. And I asked, what is the basic problem? Why do you want me to talk on this? Okay, after all, I mean, you are a developed country and so on and so forth. So you have a much better ways of conveying mathematics. No, he said, so Indians are doing much better in mathematics than our own people, in school level. That's what he was saying. Then what is the secret behind it and so on, he was just asking. But the point I wanted to convey was, he told me that what these people find difficult is word problems in mathematics. Do you understand this? Word problem means a problem narrated in words, not symbols. So this is a certain technique I'm saying. As you keep listening, you keep formulating it in your own mind. So this is a certain capacity of the mind which we will be able to easily build, and it will be extremely helpful. This is a capacity. Mind, obviously, we know, has immense capacity. The way we train it, it will be able to work. So this is something which we are losing for some reason or other reason. Anyway, so that is how it was. Okay, and this will also be in the form of verse. So this is what the modern notation is. This is how it will be represented in the ancient text. How will it be represented? So this is called chapa, you see, okay? And this is chapa square multiplied by chapa, multiply everything by chapa square and so on. You will be able to get this infinite series for sine. And let me just skip this. This is a terribly slowly converging series, all of us know. Okay, at least mathematicians who have got training in mathematics, they know terribly slowly converging series. Only if you consider some million terms, you will get 5 decimal place accuracy. Okay, that is how it will be. So the what is the point in discovering this series? If it is such a terribly slowly converging series, anyway, you will not be able to find. But Madhava seems to have found brilliant ways of turning that into fast converging series. So that has been done. That is really quite interesting. And this I thought I should just tell. There may be some computer science students. I don't think anybody who studies computer science should not be aware of this man, Donald Knuth. Okay? So he is considered a giant figure. So these textbooks that he is writing, Art of Computing, are really like Bibles, okay? Veda, if you want to use Indian terminology, if you want to use that. So that is something which is a remarkable thing. And he says, the reason for doing this, see, my major failing as a teacher was that I wasn't able to get a single one of my 28 PhD students to realize what a thrill it was to work with the source material. So the source material by which we mean this source material which are available to us, that is something which is very interesting, by which we will be able to see the evolution of thought. So how things were done at a different stage, in a different context, in a different method. So that is something which is important. Now, these are the various forms of that infinite series. That terribly slowly converging series has been converted into fast converging, and each of them is a basically refined expression. As you can see, so you have power 5 coming in the denominator, which means it will be very fast converging, okay? Now comes the story. What is your name, sir? So now you see why it has happened. So when this series was communicated by someone who studied with the help of local pundits, this is Charles Wish. This is in 1820s. He communicates this series to a higher authority for publication in a journal. So what happens is it goes on for almost 8 to 9 years, back and forth, okay? And the other person there, he says, you see, the Hindus never invented the series. So it was communicated with many others by Europeans to some learned natives in modern times. Mr. Wish sent a list of various methods. And the reason is I requested him to make further inquiries, and his reply was he had reasons to believe them to be entirely modern and derived from Europeans. Observing that not one of those used the rules could demonstrate them. You understand? So if you know some formula and if you are not able to derive, it means? So that is the kind of argument that is being presented. You understand? If somebody who is using some local fellow does not know how to arrive at this derivation of this series, so this means that the previous people did not. Okay, that is the kind of a thing, and he finally says it is too ridiculous to deserve refutation. So this is the kind of attitude which seems to have been there at some point, and he had to struggle for almost 8-9 years, and then finally it got published. Okay, and the concluding remarks. So all of us know of this Manjul Bhargava. So he was mentioning soon after he received this in 2014. He was asked, students in India, he says, see, middle power in mathematics, despite its famed legacy, his understanding goes like this. Students in India should be taught about the great ancient Indian mathematicians like Panini se shuru kiya. You understand? So he's a grammarian. But grammarian, lot of logical thinking which has gone in constructing this grammar, and therefore he considers it very important. So mathematics is always absolutely logical. Okay, so it is in this sense he uses Panini, and we of course gave some examples of Pingala, and he talks about Aryabhata, Hemachandra, Bhaskara, and so on. The reason he says is, see, they inspired me and they would inspire students across India. Okay, so this is something which is very important, and they have been conveyed in beautiful poetry. So hamara education system aisa hai. Okay, so this is how it is. So if they follow something, you also have to follow. So there is no other go. Okay, now let me conclude with Raman's quotation. So since it is National Science Day. So Raman, he says, we have, I think, developed an inferiority complex. I think what is needed in India today is the destruction of this defeatist spirit. We need a spirit of victory, a spirit that will carry us to our rightful place under the sun, a spirit which will recognize that we as inheritors of this proud civilization. How will this ever come unless you teach any of them? Okay, so that is all it is. So if that indomitable spirit were to arise, nothing can hold us back from achieving the rightful destiny, okay? So one way to do this is to get rid of the problem, is to make citizens of our nation, to shed away the cultivated ignorance by making them aware of their own scientific heritage. So efforts should be made to highlight important discoveries made in India, at least in school or in college. Okay, something should be done, definitely. History as taught in schools is hardly useful. It is essentially social history, talking about various things, suppression, oppression, and so on. And the scientific and technological achievements in India, which is either absent or misrepresented or presented in a banal manner, okay? So effort should be launched to see that this is something which is brought forth. Thank you.
Sir, first of all, thank you for such a wonderful lecture. I have a couple of questions. You said how we have lost the notation to explain what is in the slokas or the verses. So are there attempts made to understand how the notation works? Or if yes, how long will it take to, or will it have, is it possible to push it to mainstream primary school education?
Yeah.
And the second question is, I want to go talk about astrology now, because in astrology we have a lot of data from planets. We have the angles, we have the position of planets.
You mean astronomy?
Astrology also.
Okay.
So how did they make qualitative result, qualitative what do you call it, qualitative results from data, numerical data?
Okay.
So they say if the position of sun is in so and so degree and so planets are in so and so degree, the person is bound to behave like this. So
okay.
How did they make the jump?
Okay. So that second question I need not necessarily answer because it is unrelated to. It is not that I do not want to, but at least the first question I want to answer. In certain disciplines, it becomes extremely difficult for us to figure out if the tradition is lost. If it is a sort of medical discipline and if it names some herb, if the practitioner is not available, then you will not be able to do. But mathematics and astronomy happen to be discipline in which the tradition is alive, as well as we will be able to rediscover, even if it is lost, because we know what is being talked about with some hints here and there. But let me just tell you that it is not that bad because of the efforts which have been launched by some senior people who were living in 18th, 19th century. The tradition was sort of gone because they saw to it that traditional institutions are more or less gone when a new educational system was imposed. So some patashalas with great difficulty, they sort of survived, but it could not survive much long because various grants were curtailed and so on and so forth. Let me not get into the history. But the point I want to answer is, so yes, we will be able to precisely decipher and present what is there in Sanskrit verse or in sutras in the light of modern mathematical language without making any hyperbole. Okay, it will be absolutely possible, and that is what we are also trying to do with certain texts. For certain texts, it has been already done in 19th century, and there have been some scholars, and these scholars were not supported by government. They were individual scholars who had passion for this, and they have been able to do. There were a handful of scholars in 19th century as well as 20th century. Handful, okay, we'll be able to mention. So these scholars have given us some hints by which we will be able to pick up. And any serious student who has got a serious training in science will be able to pick up without much difficulty. And we need to prepare textbooks which will be available for the school children. Preparing is one thing and getting it accepted is another thing. So for getting it accepted, there has to be a certain mindset which has to change at a different level. Let me tell you, in one forum, which had to do with the national education policy, okay, so of which Manjul Bhargava was also a team member who was sort of heading, and he spent almost a year, okay, I heard from him itself and his mother. So there was a discussion forum in which I had been invited to present views as to what can be integrated and so on. So when I made some presentation that these are very interesting things and these are presented in an interesting way and therefore they could be introduced. So one of the well-known mathematicians, okay, so he came up to me after the meeting was over. Ram, you were saying that Bhaskaracharya's verses can be given. I don't think why should we give this? I said, what is wrong in doing? Okay, so he was saying, no, Bhaskara talks about some flora, fauna, some examples which people do not know. Some peacock went there and nobody knows about peacock or monkey going there. And I said, it is precisely for this reason you have to do. You understand? No, the reason quoted was surprising to me. And I said, okay, Bhaskara gives that example which was available for him. And if you take some other text, I mean, he will say some king, queen, viceroy, etc. He would give the different example. So we can give that. I said, what is wrong in giving this? So this is the mindset. That is the problem. Okay? yes.
A modern science relies on this process called peer review.
Correct.
To identify poor results from the good ones. And over time, the good ones rise up. What do you see from the evidence you've studied?
Mm-hmm.
What was their process to that allowed? I'm sure there was some not so correct results, but the good ones are the ones we remember today. What
correct.
Would have been
no.
Process?
I'll tell you. If you look at, for instance, so let us take this simple example, and which we have seen in this itself. So if you look at the kind of constructions that have been described in Shulva Sutra texts. To obtain the area of a circle. So it is a different kind of a process that they do. So you will find the value which is correct to hardly one decimal place. So later, say there has been a continuous effort on the part of astronomers as well as mathematicians over a period of time to see that their values are becoming better and better. No, this is only by continuous examination and probing into the process. So for instance, Aryabhatta gives you a value of sine, which will be correct to minutes. So later you see another person coming up with value which is far better. For some things we are able to decipher from the commentary, what could have been the process by which they would have done this. For certain other things we could not. The other thing is, you can see that if the method which has been prescribed by him is taken up to third decimal, fourth decimal in computation, because all that it requires, procedurally it is perfect. So only how far you will be able to determine. See, in the first instance, if you just take root 1 by root 2, so if you take radius as measure, then the radius is what? They are given linear measure. So if the radius is wrong at some stage, then all other things will go wrong. So you improve upon the value of the radius, and then you will be able to improve upon the values of sines also. So this is one aspect. The other aspect is certain other things which have been, so for instance, this infinite series, for instance, for pi, this is purely out of a mathematician's passion. Okay, it need not necessarily be. So a problem which bothers you, you keep on improving and then you come up with some results. So there are certain discoveries in mathematics which we find here, which are not directly relevant to a certain problem, which either you find in day-to-day affairs or in astronomy, but they have been simply pursued as a passion by them. So when you ask for peer review, I must tell you that there are forums in which people go and present. This is today also you will find in certain places called Vakyartha Sabha. So pandits assemble there, you have to sort of establish, be it philosophy, be it logic, be it grammar, be it mathematics. So this used to be there. And even today, if you find, there will be no certificates, but certain institutions who see to it that no point of time you will lose rigor. This fellow will be examined by 5 people and you have to answer in front of the assembly. So it is like today we presenting seminar in various places. That is how they ensured quality.
Sir,
oh,
my question is, you also heard about this Jain mathematics, ancient school of
Correct.
Jain mathematics.
Correct.
So any your
the verse in fact that? Which I quoted regarding the ubiquity of mathematics, Mahaviracharya, he was a Jain. So Jainas, what is quite different is their conception of universe. But when it comes to mathematics, so they have been a part of the regular stream, so like any others. So they pursued mathematics as well as they had pursued certain other disciplines like philosophy. So some of the mathematical works that we find, we have a handful of them, okay? So who have been presenting their works at least from 9th century we know. So one of the magic squares, there is Takkara Feru. So he is the first person. Then we find Narayana Pandita discussing at great length. So,
sir, I have a question. So, are there two questions actually? Is there evidence that there are mathematical problems which were considered from engineering motivations? When I see Leelavati, I see it. I mean, story of beautiful things, peacock going towards a snake, and so on and so forth. But. The difference between, say, Euler and Bhaskaracharya, whenever I read the life of Euler, I see that he is motivated by engineering applications.
Yeah.
On the other hand, is there
I would just say, when we say engineering, I think we have to keep things in mind which were used in those days. So, for instance, it can be called it as engineering design, even if you think of the quantity of stones which are required and how much of mountain you have to take, etc. So those kinds of problems will be there. Suppose you have to build, so 20 tables and 25 chairs. So then what is the amount of wood that will be required? So these kinds of things they will do in a jiffy. Okay, these kinds of problems will be there. Okay, so one, this peacock, monkey, etc. So this will be as an illustration of doing this first order equation, second order equation, and quadratic equation. So there you will construct examples from mythology, you will construct examples from flora, fauna, etc. But there are chapters which are called Krakacha Vyavahara and so on. Krakacha Vyavahara.
Krakacha Vyavahara.
So how much of wood has to be cut, etc., sawing. So those kinds of things we definitely find. But much more thing, maybe one will find, not necessarily in mathematical texts, but in architecture and certain other texts. So maybe they have more things. Or it could be purely oral tradition when the sthapatis have to do. So that is also possible.
I have one more question. Are there other languages in which there is a history of ancient mathematics?
Yeah, that's what I was mentioning. So there are texts which have been composed in other languages. Okay? You mean to say that the texts in mathematics in other languages, right?
Yes, or ideas coming which are expressed in other languages.
Yeah, true. That's what. This commentary which has been authored by people is not necessarily in Sanskrit. Particularly in Kerala, we will find Malayalam, lot of Malayalam commentaries which have been written by people. The most important text which is available for us today, with which we have been able to establish the supremacy of mathematics, the golden age, so-called 15th, 16th century, is this Yukti Bhasha, which is purely in Malayalam. Okay? So purely in Malayalam. Let me tell you one more thing. See, in this context, it is not necessarily in mathematics. Even in Vyakarana, Vedanta, Mimamsa, and other disciplines, logic, there have been scholars, extremely brilliant scholars, who may not be able to speak in Sanskrit or explain in Sanskrit. I have seen in my own life. They will be teaching only in Tamil. They can compose verses in Sanskrit, they will be able to read, interpret texts in Sanskrit. So, which means that the explanations were offered only in the local languages. Whereas, the facility to compose has been in Sanskrit language. Okay? So, and it has been a language which has been there for ages. And therefore, if you are sort of trained in that, so you will be able to communicate better in this. Okay? So, that is how it is. If you and I are asked to write an essay in mathematics or quantum mechanics in Tamil, it is impossible, right? So we have been trained to think in English, and those terms will what will come to us, right? So this is how it is. So, but I mean, if somebody asks, we may use those technical terms as it is from Sanskrit, and we will be able to communicate. If you take this Ganita Yukti Bhasha, for instance, so there are technical terms will be in Sanskrit and Malayalam, they will be sort of same, but the language is in Malayalam.
Hello, sir. Coming to the evolution of Indian textbooks, which are given in our school system and the college system, like we know about Ramanujam only in our history book, but we did not have any of his equation in our mathematics books. Like recently, I came across a book called Paramanu Shastra. So, for the past 70 years of evolution of our textbooks, our education should be logically more than happy to say that we Indian discovered this, we Indian did this. But why there was no steps taken to portray our own success or our own inventions? Because if just an introduction or just one unit of or one paragraph introduction is given, if the student is interested, he might explore it. But we are not even given the introduction of our own history.
Yeah, that has been answered. No, there is a mindset problem of people who are sitting in NCERT board or some other board, whatever board, which has to decide.
Sir, but if it is 5 to 10 years problem, it should be okay. But for the past 70 years
or 80 years doesn't matter. So unless the mindset is changed, what can be done? Okay. See, it is true. So more and more people should raise voice against this. How many of us are, for instance, are aware, first of all? I have to admit, till my MSc, physics, I did not know Aryabhatta or Bhaskara. Not even the name, forget about their contributions. That is how the school textbooks are done. So as I told you, in National Education Policy meeting, so this mathematics professor said, why should Bhaskaracharya be introduced? What will you say?
Sir, due to time constraint, this will be the last question.
Huh.
Check. Sir, when you said Pankti is one and Rupa is one, you seem to be the only person in the auditorium to know that. That's also because when you try to explain something, that is usually something that has already been explained or an alternative solution to what has already been presented.
Okay.
So I'm just trying to understand, that's probably why we are being ridiculed.
No.
Is there something that we have in the text which has not been made, you know, explained or made aware or discovered by the West? Is there anything? I'm saying in all this, if you can find one thing, that would make all the difference, is what I'm saying.
No. Are you asking me something which is available in the Indian mathematical tradition which cannot be bet?
Yeah, no, I'm saying Pascal's triangle. Oh, yeah, we already have it here. Value of pi. Yeah, we have it here. So that is not the, I mean, obviously people will ridicule us when we say that.
No,
you have
not
to,
ridiculing.
You have to come up with something that is not there.
No, please understand.
Yes.
All that we are trying to say is, so this is a tradition which has been practicing science and mathematics equally well as it has been practicing philosophy and religion. what is normally known to the society is only this. That it has been, that there has been a scientific heritage is not known. So when Manjul Bhargava makes a statement that, I mean, this was quite inspiring to me. So is he trying to deceive the audience by saying this? Or when Donald Knuth makes this statement, so there is something which is very fascinating about it. Now the point is, as the ideas evolve, as time evolves, different people will invent different things in their own ways. But when one has to give a name to a certain discovery, so then we made the statement that it has to go to the founder of this instead of giving this. This is all we made. So it is not a question of just thumping our breasts, okay, so that we have discovered first. It is not for this. The exposition was primarily to make aware of your own scientific heritage, which China has done in a very, very, very systematic manner, and it has been doing. So this actually creates a certain psychological effect in the person. So it is for this reason I concluded this by saying, quotation, making quotations. Coming to your question, is there one thing which we will be able to proudly proclaim which has not been done? I can tell you that even today, after Euler, okay, so he is a brilliant man. So there is a certain technique which these people have developed to solve this second order indeterminate equation, and this is the best method for arriving at solution. Okay? So if you want one or two things of that nature, we will be definitely able to find out. And by the time any society will be judged at a given point of time, what is available with them and what have they done? So even with respect to mathematics, the point I wanted to convey and what thrilled David Mumford was to find a society which is dealing with sine function in such a brilliant manner. So this is a different kind of a thinking. So that is what we need to understand. So we are not saying that you found this, I found this. You say aerodrome, so I have this aeroplane. Aisa kuch nahi hai. Okay? So we are not talking that nonsense here. So the point I am trying to convey is, these things have been done differently in a different context. As a scientist, I would be thrilled if a student comes up with the solution to a mathematical problem in a new way. I will appreciate it. So this expands our horizons and it increases creativity. That is why I'm just saying this is something which is very important. Okay?
Excuse me, there is no paucity of time here at all, because between 6 and 8 we are having the program.
Yeah.
So if anybody wants to ask any questions, please ask the questions.
Okay.
It is very rare to get a person like Dr. Ramasubramanian. So please feel free, have your food late also.
Yeah, yeah, we have 10 more minutes, yes, definitely, till 8 at least.
No, a small point.
Ah.
I have studied this in mathematics, and I find that mathematics in poetry, specified as poetry, I do not know in any other language.
Yeah, this is communication.
That
there are two things. One is mode of communication, the other is content. So, mode of communication is obviously unique. Okay? So, true. That has been done in local languages also. That is what other thing is. So the poetry giving rise to mathematics is something which is unique to this tradition, first of all. The kind of meters that we find in this tradition is something which is not comparable in others. Okay? Definitely, certainly not in English. We have just iamb, trochee, and a few things. So the richness that you have here has given rise to certain interesting mathematical problems and solutions and recursive relations. So that is something which is a different thing. So content-wise, and even technically, that's what I was trying to say. So a method which is unparalleled, which is most efficient, we will be able to find. That is what is called Chakravala. Yeah. Which has bet even Riddle and Lagrange. They came up with some solution, but that is not something which is as efficient as this, if you want to solve that problem. Why do you want to solve that problem? I mean, we can ask the question to mathematicians. why do they attempt? I mean, they just keep moving in their own spaces. Yeah. Huh. Pardon?
In his statistical,
huh.
Statistics have been incorporated in.
Oh, not much, to my knowledge. Yeah, as a statistics, as a science, I don't see. If at all, one has to say it has to be something which has to do with astrology, the other person. That's what? No. The thing is, this notion of probability I have not come across in the standard texts. Okay? So, which forms the fundamental thing for developing statistics. So, we don't find as such. To my knowledge, I don't know. These standard texts on mathematics, they don't deal. But maybe there are instances in other contexts which may have this. I have no answer.
Anything in complex numbers?
Complex. Even the whole number was not acceptable to the world. Only natural numbers was accepted. So at different stages, different things evolve. We need to understand. So people were only dealing with whole numbers. The notion of void and infinite was really something which societies avoided, civilizations avoided. Whereas, to include zero as a number, that was a giant leap. And prescribe operations with zero was a giant leap, if you look at the history of mathematics as it evolved. Because, I mean, it is zero is a bizarre number, all said and done. I mean, it will just throw out or collapse things and so on and so forth. So, to include that itself was a giant leap. So they did that. And after that, I mean, came real numbers and various other numbers. And like zero was integrated at some stage, this complex numbers was integrated at a different stage of evolution of mathematics. So there is no question of having complex numbers in Indian mathematics.
So even fractions were not allowed as numbers by the Greeks.
Yeah, at some stage, yes. But in Indian texts, I must tell you that there will be a chapter called Parikarmashtakam. This Parikarmashtakam, the very name, I mean the names are also coined in a very intuitive way that will convey what is being done there. I mean that is how the names, even Jya for instance, that is a god. So all the names that you find here will be something which you can easily relate. That is how things have been coined. So parikarma means something which is paritaha kriyamanam karma, a mathematical operation which is done everywhere. So which means the basic fundamental operation, some plus, minus, multiplication, division, and square, square root, cube, cube root. So these are called parikarma. So parikarma with whole numbers will be first discussed, then parikarma with fractions will be discussed later, then parikarma with thirds will be discussed. Okay, so this is how these texts are developed. Yes, please.
Sir, in the Vasco da Gama came to India in, you know, end of 15th century. Kerala School of Mathematics was very strong at that time.
Yeah.
Is there evidence that, you know, Western mathematics was influenced in a strong way by Indian mathematics?
See, there are no concrete evidences with which we will be able to prove that these ideas got transmitted to the West. There have been propositions which have been made by some bright people. And they have written certain things also, but they are not quite convincing by which we will be able to show this. But definitely before this 15th century, around 8th century, 9th century, etc. So lot of ideas got transmitted from here to other places. So we will be able to see definitely in some of the Islamic works, they have got translated. And after that, their ways of thinking, their ways of working got significantly modified. For that we have evidences, but for the transmission of the fundamentals of calculus or this infinite series, etc., we don't have concrete evidences. True. That is true. This has been evolving. In fact, this is true of most of the concepts in science. See, even Newton or Galileo or Weierstrass, when we look at... No. His question was the other way around. His question was, because Vasco da Gama came, did he carry back this idea and take it to... No, he carried back. No, that's what I'm saying, for which we don't have. That's what your question was, right? So carrying this knowledge to the West is something for which we don't have concrete evidences. Textual evidences we don't have. But transmission of knowledge is quite possible at all stages. That we should grant. That's what I said. So they started thinking in a... See, let me give you one more concrete evidence. Since this question came, we all know that Islamic languages, they write from right to left. Okay, we write from left to right. They write from right to left. But even in those works, if you find the way they represent numbers, they will do from left to right. This itself is a concrete evidence that this decimal place value system of representing numbers got transmitted from here to there. And still they do that. Okay? In fact, there are some studies which are going on. So whether this should be there, we should not be there, what is the kind of... But that is what is there. Okay? Let me tell you.
We request all of you to please stay back for a vote of thanks and national anthem. People who have questions can meet sir personally after the national anthem.
Okay. So whose watch is this?
Thank you, sir, for an insightful and engaging talk. We know there would be questions. We would request you to kindly take it offline after the event. May I now request Professor B.S. Murthy from the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering to come up on the dais and present the Ma Saraswati's Murthy as a token of gratitude and respect. Thank you, Professor Murthy. Now I call upon Purvaji to propose the vote of thanks.
Namaste, everyone. We consider ourselves to be blessed to have Professor Ramasubramanian as our chief guest at our event. Your speech was really enlightening to all of us, sir. Thank you, Professor Ramasubramanian ji, for allocating your time for us in your busy schedule. I, Purva Srivastava, on behalf of Vande Mataram family, would like to thank each one of us for your unconditional love and support that you have shown to us in the past 3 years. Thank you, faculties, our seniors, alumni of IIT Madras, elders, students, light and sound people, videography for your unconditional love and support. We started our journey 4 years back on 118th birth anniversary of the great son of Mother India, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Our journey continues with same spirit, commitment, determination, and enthusiasm. The shloka from Ramayana, Janani Janma Bhumeshcha Swargadapi Garyasi, keeps us energized and focused. So we will be keep serving. We pray for your love and support. Jai Hind, Vande Mataram.
Thank you, Purvaji. There's an additional piece of information. Tomorrow at 6:15 p.m. at RK Convention Center at Mylapore, Professor Ramasubramanian ji will deliver a talk on the significance of Indian calendrical system. If you are free, please join. Now I invite Sri Hari Ganesh Ji once again for the national anthem and request you all to stand up at your place.
जनगणमनाधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंधु गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभाशिष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे, जय हे, जय हे, जय हे, जय हे।